Before start with this webinar, I like to introduce our principal sir, Dr. Bala Ganapati sir. He is an initiated this webinar, and I'll request our principal sir, Dr. Bala Ganapati sir, to tell few words about this webinar. Over to you, sir.
Dear friends, Ashok and Rita Patel Institute of Physiotherapy, a constituent of Charusat University of Science and Technology, is happy to introduce the ARIP Charusat Alumni Webinar during this pandemic period of COVID-19. But it will be a continuous activity in our institute for enhancing the learning in the field of physiotherapy. This will give an opportunity for our alumni to share their knowledge and experience across the globe through this platform, and also to create the future leaders in our profession. Hope this platform shows the pathway for the next generation of physios, which will mold them to have a better life. Now, thank you for all of you who is attending this webinar.
Okay, so thank you very much, sir, for your kind word. And before this start, I like to introduce our two speakers. First, I'll tell you about Dr. Payal Vasi, and she is an NHS volunteer and as an sessional lecturer as Nottingham International College at United Kingdom, and she is our ARIP alumni from the 2010 batch. And our second speaker, he is Dr. Vikas Ratnaparam. He is from 2009 batch, and at present he is working as a product analyst at the ARIPFest Technologist at Punjab Chandigarh. And I request Dr. Payal Vasi to begin with the session. And over to you, Payal Vasi.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, so for this introduction. And before starting, I would like to take a permission to share my screen.
Yeah.
So is it visible to all of you?
Yes.
Okay. So as all of you know that this is the introduction given for me, so few of you might be know me, that because few of you might be my juniors or my seniors, and of course my teachers know me very well, but few of you might be thinking that who is she? So I would like to give you my informal introduction. So few of you might be thinking that why I am here. So you have to think that I'm here to share some success story or my success story. So no, it is not like that. I'm not here to share some success story. I'm someone like you who normally plan like this, who think that to catch this flag is very easy. But once I realized this reality that, oh, this is very difficult. My plan is very smooth and the reality is something like this. Then I normally close my planning diary like this, and I throw my plans away like this. So basically, I just want to tell you that I'm just like you. So feel free to ask questions at the end of this session, and be with me for this session. So coming to the real business, we are going to talk about entrepreneurship. So what do you mean by entrepreneurship? How physiotherapist can be an entrepreneur? For me, everything that is quite scary to begin with, but it is very rewarding when you succeed, that everything is entrepreneurship. So today I'm going to motivate you to think about entrepreneurship. So for that, first of all, it is very important to start taking risk. You can see this man, he's taking a risk for his life. He's saving his life. So start taking risk in your life. So what could be the risk for us as a physiotherapist? It could be anything that can change the culture or change the game. For example, to take people from here to here, that could be a changing of culture, changing their mind. So that cultural change could be in a particular physiotherapy tradition, or few of you might be thinking to join some other profession or work with other professionals. For example, like this. How many of you have heard this, that before a few days I was in gym and because of vigorous leg activity, I'm having a pain? Or few of you might be heard about disc prolapse and many cervical spine and lumbar spine problem. So I think that if physiotherapists are there in this area, the picture, the result would be totally different. So I'm not against any profession. Of course, we respect all the profession, but this is my belief that if we are here, we have a knowledge of anatomical area, we have a biomechanical knowledge, so picture might be quite different. Then this is IT sector. So everybody need us in IT sector, in a manufacturing company, in all type of manufacturing company. So I think everyone needs you as a physio. There are few companies, they are appointing physiotherapists, they are recruiting physiotherapists as a real physiotherapist or their employees. But still, we are lacking in awareness. And it is our role. We can do this as, we can choose this as a part of entrepreneurship. So this could be one of our idea to change the culture. So within last 4 minutes or 5 to 10 minutes, I give you many ideas for ergonomical point of view. Why I was talking about they need us in an industry, and they need us in a manufacturing company, because look at this, if we are here, we can design everything according to our biomechanical knowledge, and that would be a great change for all of us. So I think we could do something better, we could change something by entering in designing. This is something, if you are thinking about your personal business, so you can start your personal training center with a juice bar. This was the idea which was given by me within last 5 minutes. And if you are fortunate enough and your uncle, your parents, or anybody from your family are some industrialist or they are running a business, then you can simply call them and just explain your ideas or utilize this type of social function, which might be very boring for all of us, but you can go there and just simply talk about your ideas and you can utilize your time wisely. Additionally, if you want to change the current physiotherapy culture, like the Natasha Wilch has done, was the one, she's very famous physiotherapist. She started with a car and a vision, and she won the award in 2017 as Entrepreneur of the Year. Her motivation was very simple. She wanted to give a quality treatment to the patients. So she was not allowing anybody who was not passionate like her in her team. So her motto was very simple. She just wanted to provide a quality treatment. Sorry. So she started her mobile physiotherapy clinic in 2015. And within 2 years, she has won this award. So don't do this. Don't throw away your ideas. Allow yourself to think differently. Start thinking differently. It is good. If you are thinking in the same old way and if you are expecting some different result, then I think it is not possible to get something new from doing all the same work. And I believe that it is better to leave the comfort zone as soon as possible to get a progress in your life. So start thinking differently. That is good. Few of you might be thinking that I'm not as creative as she is talking. Creativity is slightly, totally different. I can't think creatively. Then it's okay. You have another option. You might be have some good hobby. So you can start that hobby to grow up. So for example, do you think that I'm a good dancer? Or do you think that I'm good at Garba? So this is a picture of power Garba classes. One aerobic Garba classes is run by our physiotherapist only. She has she has attended the aerobic certification course, and now she is running aerobic Garba classes. So this could be one idea to start with. This is yoga classes. Of course, if one of a few of us are feeling that your flexibility is really good, and you could do something with yoga. I knew one of my students was very good at yoga, and he used to perform everywhere through his yoga skill. So this is an idea for someone like him, or from someone from all of you who are flexible enough. So you can start something like this. Remember, why it is very important, why you can make a change, because you have that anatomical knowledge, you have that biomechanical knowledge, which can make a change. You're not doing simply just yoga, or not doing simply just aerobic classes. You are applying your knowledge, you can set a proper protocol. You can take care of warm-up exercise. You can take care of proper dosage and cool down. You know the importance. You know the physiology. You know the importance of stretching. So you can make the change. This is one picture of neuro rehab music therapy. They are, if you want to search about this, you can simply Google it. They are basically working with mental health patient. So if music is your hobby, you can do something like this. So start investing your time wisely. That could be very good for you. Start thinking about your strengths, your weakness, because it is very important. I'm not talking about your physical strength, but anything that you might like to do, that could be your strength. Write it down for you, because it is very important. When you will know your strength, your clear path where you want to work. So I'm talking about me. I'm someone who found that I can teach creatively. So creative teaching is my strength. When I realized that, when it was about 2 years when I was studying master's, and as per my surname, my roll number is always last. So all of us were listening to my classmates about ethics. All of us are presenting some topic on ethics, and it was my last roll number and my turn, and I'm going to present about code of ethics. Everyone was bored. Anyone don't want to listen to me, but I started with examples from movies. So I conducted the lecture, and I tried to explain each code by examples of some movies. And my lecture became very interesting. Everyone loved to listen to me. So this is where first time I clicked that, oh, I can be a good teacher. But this was just a thought. Then after a few days, while studying in master's only, few of my juniors came to me and they want to learn about axes and planes. And I just took a pen and paper, pen for axes and paper for a plane. And I explained them that you can learn easily like this. And they got my point within 5 minutes. So these are the some area where I realized that the teaching could be my strength. So I was lucky enough to work as an assistant professor for 1.5 years in a physiotherapy college. This is one video why it is here, because I used to teach my students like this. This is for this video I used to teach them about abdominal exercise, of course, to teach them about abdominal muscle. I used the videos from a movie Sultan to teach them about a circuit training. So this is my way, and this is why I'm sharing this, because I want to motivate you that try to find your strength. What is your strength? Of course, I was not working as an entrepreneur, but that skill gave me that job, gave me the confidence. And I think because of that confidence, I'm in front of you. That job gave me skills, time management, leadership, communication, and many more. And because of that, I think right now I'm able to work between these Britishers and I'm teaching them biology. I know it was quite difficult for me to teach them and to face them, but after some time, I think that this is better, and teaching is my strength, so I can do something like this. Right now, I'm working on something which we can really say startup. I'm working on a YouTube channel. I want to start a physiotherapy channel where I can share my creative ideas with students. Of course, with this disclaimer that the information contained in the video should not be used as a substitute for books and other academic material. The information provided here is to assist you with your studies. I want this disclaimer because I know I used to work as a teacher, so I know that it is easy for students to say that Payal ma'am teach this in YouTube channel. So this is very important. Yeah, so I want to work on something like this where I can teach physiotherapy in some easy manner through the example I just given about the exercise plane with pen and paper. So this is my idea, and right now I'm working on this. Then I'm trying to think, I'm just thinking about starting a channel for a Gujarati medium physiotherapy students, because when I was studying and when I was conducting the classes in first year students, I have seen that they were not, it is not the problem of intelligence or problem of English, it is just a problem about confidence. As per the statistic provided by secondary and higher secondary education board, 48,204 students of English medium appeared for SSC exam, whereas the total number of Gujarati medium students in the exam was 8.89 lakh. That is almost 18 times more than English medium students. So Gujarati is just a language, so don't worry about it. And I want to, this is one of my another idea that I want to tell them, I want to teach them by correlating it and by making it easy, that don't worry, you can do it. So if any of you are interested to join me with any of these two ideas, this Gujarati channel for Gujarati medium students, of course that is going to be in English only, but it is just a boost of their confidence, and a channel for a physiotherapy student. So maybe I might be work on this or this. So any of you might be interested in any of this idea, you can contact me. This is my contact detail. I think we would talk on that, and we could make something different. Of course, this is a zero profit business right now, but at least we can start from somewhere. So this is a take home message for you, that start thinking differently, because every year, this is the intake in Gujarat, around 5,000 students are getting graduated with you. This is intake. So every year around 5,000 students are getting graduate with you. So your competition is not only with your classmates, your seniors, or physiotherapist of your city. It is with many more whom you can't even see. So stop competing with your classmates, friends, physiotherapists around you. Start competing with yourself, with your weakness. So start thinking differently. You can change the culture. If you think that your hobby could be the reason for your success, then start doing that. Don't let your vision be dictated by your current capabilities and skills. Use vision as a reason to learn, to grow, and to rise up. I think right now I am doing that. I'm using my vision to learn, to grow, and to rise up. So thank you for listening. This is from my side. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer your questions after this, after Vikas Pai's session.
Thank you so much, Dr. Payal, for your motivational words. This will definitely motivate many of us and to become an entrepreneur. And I'm also believing that if we have a little bit of passion and dedication, definitely we will achieve something in future. But for that, we have a out of box thinking, and that we have to start with now only, right? So with that, I'll invite our second speaker, Dr. Vikas Ratnapara. So over to you, Dr. Vikas.
Yep, thank you, Hamal sir. Right, I'll go ahead and share my screen.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, let me, is it visible?
Yes.
Perfect, yeah. So, all right, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you all for joining this webinar. And, organized by ARIP Alumni Webinar Series. And I'm thankful to ARIP family and Bala sir for giving me an opportunity. So coming back to the theme, as Payal has already paved wonderful path for me, so it will be easier for me to, move on with my content. So when I first, saw the theme that physiotherapist as an entrepreneur, I introspected it, and there are so many physiotherapists who owns a clinic. So can't we have a theme like physiotherapy as a owner of the clinic? But then again, I thought of it, and then I saw that there are so many physiotherapists who are successfully running their clinics. And, few of them have their clinics like 2 or 3 or maybe 4, 5, 6 clinics, the chain of clinics. So should we consider all of them as an entrepreneur? Whenever you Google the definition of entrepreneur, it will come out that it says that who sets up a business or businesses taking on financial risk in the hope of profit. But most of the time, we forget the word financial risk. Entrepreneurship is all about risk. I think someone has his mic on.
I request all of you to please mute your mic.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. So, yeah. So let's dive into the content. So, I'll see that how you need to plan your business. It can be opening a physiotherapy clinic, a chain of clinic, or maybe any kind of business. If you want to plan a physiotherapy clinic, I'll give a couple of layout plans for the physiotherapy clinic, and then 3S model, which is social, sustainable, and scalable model. And what can be few marketing mantras and the conclusion. So moving ahead, yeah, so this is about me. Currently, I'm working as a product analyst with Edifex Technologies at Mohali. And before that, I pursued my master's in hospital administration from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. And there, as a part of curriculum, I had an opportunity to work with few consultancies and few of the hospitals like Zydus and Fortis, to name the few. Before that, I pursued my bachelor's and master's in rehabilitation from our beloved ARIP. And moving back to the topic, right? So the business plan. So any of the business plan, may it be physiotherapy clinic or anything, it will start with market research. You need to look out for legal liabilities. You need to look for financing. And there is a particular model which is called as a business model canvas, which you have to develop. So we'll take one example and we'll go ahead with this one. So let's take market research. So, you know, like no business can start. No business can start with precise market research. So here precision is the key. And there are two types of, you know, answers which you need to find. One is supply related and the one is demand related. So first one is demand related. So first question is, who are your patients? Whether they are geriatric population or the fitness enthusiastic, who are your patient? What is their specific need of physiotherapy? Why do they need physiotherapy? And there are so many physiotherapists or providers in the market, why they'll choose me? So these are the demand related questions. And then there are supply related questions, that what is the size of market? How many physiotherapists are there? How many prospective clients are there? What is the structure of market? Is it a monopoly that, you know, there is a big giant who is serving the, like, who is having 80%, 90% of the market, or there are small providers, or there are, you know, tie up with hospitals. And once you have answer of all these questions, you need to choose a niche market and the scope of your practice. And believe me, defining a niche business is very crucial in any business, including physiotherapy. And one of the biggest mistakes, which, you know, I have seen over the period of time, which is going into a business and, you know, business tries to make everything to everyone, and that can decide the fate of their business. But by narrowing your focus, you can build your business, and by targeting the niche market, you can support your potential clients. So this is the first thing. Then second one is legal liabilities. How can you avoid legal conflicts? So there are permissions which you need to take care of. And in India specifically, I have not seen, you know, this kind of legal issues where small, and specifically for small business entities, where like, and almost they are settled out of court. But if you plan to expand your strategies, then you need, or you plan to expand your business, then you need to focus on this particular aspect. The first one is business permission. So you need to take all necessary permissions from local municipal corporation. And it can be fire safety NOC or business registration, property tax, etc., etc. Then there is health specific permissions, which can be your local registration for state council or IAP or so many. I mean, you better know about that than me. And the final one is insurance. So mistakes can happen, but it comes with a cost. So you need to insure yourself and your business to avoid those litigations. And then there are a type of, you know, property insurance or personal insurance and professional insurance. So you need to look into that. And to avoid all this, you need to have a very good consent form and proper documentation for all your procedures. And specifically, if you have a single clinic or a chain of clinic, you need to have a SOPs for all your procedures and, you know, kind of activities, daily activities. And then this is very much important part. And I have seen so many businesses ruined because of this signed agreements. You know, like, it can be savior in the business. There is no scope for word of mouth assurance in business. Either you're doing business with your father, your brother, your close friend, your whoever it is, but you need to, you know, have all things documented, signed on a legal stamp paper, may it be partnership agreement or annual maintenance contract with the service provider. So this is the basic thing which we have to focus on. And financing, this is very important. You know, finance is an art of passing money from one hand to another until it disappears. So sometimes, you know, like, we plan a physiotherapy clinic and we see that I mean, I'll have this much of area and I'll hire this much of physiotherapist, I'll have these instruments. But we, if you want to be an entrepreneur, then you have to, you know, change your strategies. So there are few things which you have to focus, right? So one is the source of income, the income and expenditure statement. Then in expenditure also, there are subheadings, which is fixed and variable. Then there is a profit loss statement. N. So we'll look, you know, all this income and expenditure and cash flow in detail. But this one is contingency fund. So there are mishaps which are bound to happen, but no one can predict this. But you need to have some amount of money as a contingency fund for the same. So this is, you know, like basic income and expenditure statement. So if you say that my XYZ clinic, and I'm going to offer fitness services, physiotherapy sessions, one-to-one coaching. So how many sessions you will have? Suppose you will have 5 sessions a day and you are going to charge 500 rupees. So it will be 2,500 rupees per day. So, and you are going to open, like, you know, keep open your clinic for 7 days a week. So then it will be like 2,500 into 30. And same way you can calculate that how much you are going to earn. And so this is your income statement and your expenditure statement. So in expenditure, you will have the material cost, equipment rentals for your instruments, the salary of yourself, the wages of your coworkers, and then there are general and administrative charges, which are accounting and legal fees, license fees, marketing fees, bank charges, interest charge. And this is also important part, depreciation and amortization, which most of the time we forget, but this is a very important topic and which we have to consider while opening a clinic. And then there's insurance, office rent, utility charges, include light bill, telephone bill, etc. So that is how you can manage your income and expenditure statement. And this is not after opening a clinic. You should have some prediction before opening a clinic so that you can manage your cash flow. Right. So this is a cash flow document that how much revenue you are going to generate from product sales and service. So most of the time when I see physiotherapy clinics, they are offering services only. But if you focus on product sales also, then it can be a huge chunk of your revenue. Product sales, by mean, if you are having a fitness, then you can sell supplements or you can have souvenirs of the joints or, you know, one day, like, if your patient is getting treated, then one day you can treat them without any instrument and it will be with help of TheraBand and TheraTubes and so on. And then you can tell them that these are the, I mean, TheraBands or whatever is available from our reception and you can get it, you know, like purchase it and do your exercise at home. And at the end of financial year, you'll see that your revenue will be, you know, like inflated. And then there are a few, you know, cash disbursement. And so that is how you can manage your cash flow. And all right, so now we have all the information. So this is, you know, one of the important thing you have to generate, which is called a business model canvas. It is a physiotherapy clinic or any kind of business model. You need to open it. I mean, you need to create this one. So here, for example, I am seeing, like, I write the A to Z Fitness Solutions Private Limited. So for in customer segment, you need to identify who are your customers. So here, suppose I am seeing that sports injury patients from nearby sports academy, then baby boomers. So those who born after World War II, and now they'll have their geriatric need, and millennials or what we call Gen Z or, you know, Generation Z, those who born in the millennial or after 2000, so they'll have their fitness need. What is the value proposition? So what is the value you are going to deliver to each of this customer segment, right? So you need to find it and which customers you are going to satisfy with which need. You have to identify and put it in this particular model. Sorry. And then there are channels. So which are the channels through which you are going to connect with this particular segments and which one works best? Like, so for geriatric population, it won't work same as you are going to connect with millennials. So you need to have your channels, you know, differently, and how you are going to manage that relationship with your client. And so these are the, you know, planning point or cost point of view. So who are going, so what is going to be your key activities to deliver this particular value proposition? So if you are going to offer services, so it can be Zumba or one-to-one coaching or nutritional advice or anything. And you are going to sell the product. So it can be sales of souvenir, fitness equipment, supplements, and the marketing. And who are your key resources? It can be infrastructural resources or human resources, which we have discussed earlier. and who can be the key partner to deliver this value. So if you are focusing on a sports academy, particular individuals, then you need to tie up with the management, or you need to tie up with the medical professionals for referrals for physiotherapy conditions, then old age groups to focus on this geriatric population, or you need to tie up with the colleges to get this millennial population. And so this half of portion is focusing on your cost structure. So what is the most important cost you are going to inherit in your business? Mostly it will be capital cost. So it can be the rent or purchase of your area, and then the instrumentation or physiotherapy equipments. And which are the key resources can be most expensive, and which key activities are most expensive, or which marketing activities are most expensive. So you need to find it out and put it here, and revenue stream. So these are the very important questions, that what value you are going to offer to customer and how much they will pay, what they are currently paying for that service, and what you are going to offer them over and above that service so that they can pay more. So specifically here, we are going to answer that revenue will come from this particular segment by providing a value proposition to specifically through these channels. All right, so you have to create this business canvas, and then you can go ahead. Moving back quickly, so here I have randomly chosen three layout plan. So layout of your physiotherapy clinic is very much important. So this is a basic rectangular or square kind of layout. So this is an entrance, this is a front desk and waiting room, but we won't suggest from interior point of view that front desk and waiting room, like there is around 6 to 8 feet of difference or gap here. So receptionist can't call with a loud voice, so every time he or she has to go here and ask the patient, and it will, at the end of the day, it will have a lot of impact. And then billing office, we don't need it. So examination room, we can move it here, and we can here we can have examination room too, and or staff room, and we can connect it with front desk so that your staff can move back and forth these two clinics, and or a personal treatment room, and this is the gym area. So again, this is a good example. So if this is a corner property, then it will have a ample amount of light and air circulation, but the flow is in the entry point. Then layout second, again, this is a very faulty layout which I got. So here, they have only few sitting area which don't cater the need, and here washroom is near the staff office and the gym area, and the entrance is nearby. So again, it will create a foul smell or anything like that. And the treatment room one and treatment room two are on two opposite sides, so the space management is not particular, so you need to look for these faults while designing your clinic. And the third one and the best one is, so this is the entrance area, reception, and the sitting area. So everything is perfect. This is the major consultation room, primary consultation room. So this is, easily accessible, and washrooms are also covered. This is a staff room or pantry, and everyone can access from both the ends. So here what I can suggest is you can make this area open, and you can create gym area, and you can have these three plinths for personal treatment room. So again, this is a good example. So you need to look out for various layouts before planning your clinic. And so 3S model. Whenever you have a business plan and business canvas ready, you need to think that whether is it social? Are you going to create any social impact based out of this model? If no, then again, you need to rework on it. If it is social, then it needs to be sustainable. You can implement it at one point of time, but it should go along with the flow. And the last one is scalable. You can, it should be replicable. This business canvas should be replicable to anywhere, any area. Again, you have to do your research, market research, and everything for that particular geography. But this is a very important, any of the success of business canvas will hugely dependent on social, scalable, and sustainable particular things. And these are the few marketing tactics which you have to adopt if you want to. So go paperless or reduce your papers and go digital and use social networking website, may it be Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, whatever. And you can have online appointments. So one of the example, like we have implemented it in one of the reputed hospital in Mumbai, is we told patient to book online appointments before any consultation. So most of the time we have seen that patients tend to go to Google and then type our hospital name and then they'll book their appointment. So it will have a, you know, this, what we call in IT, search engine optimization. So your particular clinic or, you know, business entity's name will be displayed prominently on all search engine. And then if possible, you can develop an Android and iOS application. I would highly recommend nowadays because it hugely reduces your marketing cost. You don't have to send a flyers and, you know, anything like that. You can go digital. And like, so if you have an application, you can kind of create a push notification that your appointment is 20 minutes, like after 20 minutes and from home, your home to our clinics, like Google Map is showing 20 minutes of traveling. So if you need to start now so that you don't miss an appointment. So you have to think such out of box strategies for capturing new market as well as to retain your your existing patients also. So yeah, this is it. And again, this is one of the favorite, you know, take home message that if you want to be an entrepreneur, may it be physiotherapy or any of business. So this one example has been, this one survey has been done in 2009. So most of the entrepreneurs were started their companies at the age of 40. So age is no limit. Education, 95% of them had bachelor's and 47% of them had advanced degrees. So almost all of us fit in this. Motivation criteria is there. 70% of them were married when they started. So if you are married, don't worry. You know, better off will be a motivation force for you. If you have children, don't worry. 50% of the entrepreneurs have children. They had industry experience of 6 years in total. And last thing I would like to mention is serial entrepreneurship. If you forget everything from this presentation, just take one thing. If you are going to start up anything, then you need to have a clear entry and exit strategy. All entrepreneurs leave their startup once it becomes successful and try to venture out into new area or new forte. So don't bound yourself and move out and explore the world. I think that should be it. And this is my contact details. You feel free to reach out to me, text me, mail me, connect with me on LinkedIn anytime. And I think that should be it. We can proceed for Q&A. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vikas, for your informative session. And definitely this will help to many of our students to become an entrepreneur after their BPT or MPT. So now we'll open the question answer round. So if you have any doubts or the question, then you can ask.
Hello everyone. My name is Pranav. I have recently passed from the last year from ARIP. I have a question to Dr. Vikas, sir. For example, if I am an owner of my own clinic, for instance, in the month of September, 50 patients visited and have taken advantage of a good quality treatment. And in the next month of August, which is the month of August, only 10 patients visited and have undergone a good quality treatment. But if you are indulged in an education platform, for example, an assistant professor, then at least every month a fixed amount of pay will be credited in your account. So what to say about this discrepancy? And in India, not if you provide excellent treatment, excellent infrastructure and advanced treatment, but external contextual factors like money, exercise adherence and many more has a highest effect on the patient. So what to say about this discrepancy, sir?
Right, yeah, I think it's a valid question. So, you know, when I first, told the definition of entrepreneurship, it's all about taking a financial risk, right? You are saying that a particular, you know, like I'll have a amount of money which will be credited in my account at the end of month. But again, I am not doing something out of box. So you need to think creative. And, you know, if there is a will, there is a way. So if you have a good strategy and you can't, you know, like you are saying that out of 50, only 10 has come up. So again, there is something wrong with your strategy. That is what I can suggest. So you need to look into your mistakes. And then you need to, you know, see it as an opportunity. And second part is, the capital, like you are saying that we don't have that much of capital to start a clinic. So for that, I'm saying that if you have a very good business plan or canvas, then there are so many, you know, venture capitalists or investors who are willing to invest in your startup. But given condition, it should be a good idea.
Sir, but there are more than 70 colleges of physiotherapy or providing physiotherapy courses in Gujarat. So why to take that risk? Either to join as a professor?
Then you can, I'm not saying that you can open a physiotherapy clinic. You can open anything which is out of box. Right? I mean, so this is an example I've given as an entrepreneur, but you can replicate this business canvas in any of the idea. But yeah, assistant professor is a good, you see the panel and I am here, Payal is here and many of us are here because of their effort. So yeah, that is a good idea and feel free to join the force.
Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Pranav, can I just add one thing? Every job has its own and other things. Don't assume that if you are in a teaching job, there is no risk involved. There are different risks and different financial incentives. So the greater the risk you take, the greater the chance of getting more financial
risks. Okay, sir.
Anyone, you can ask your question into the chat box also.
Okay, I think Dhruv sir has a question, how to sell our ideas to the venture capitalist. All right, so there is a process which is called, crowdfunding you need to have your ideas clearly laid out on a business canvas. So which the model I have presented, that is the common format across the industry. So you need to put out your idea, you need to put out your value proposition, key customer, target segment, cost structure and everything. And once you have it ready, you can, so there are a few exhibitions or conferences which happens. You need to participate in that and then you can, promote your business model and directly there and then only you will have a investor or venture capitalist who will invest in your idea. I think that answers your question, sir.
Okay. Anyone? We can go for one more question. If anybody have any question.
Dhruv sir has a question for Payal. Payal, you are on mute.
So do we need to train ourselves for YouTube channel starting? Yes, of course, but you can start it with small budget and there is no need to actually train yourself, but of course you require a good voice quality and for that you can take a technical help. And do we get we need to get some pre-training. Yeah, so I'm answering for the same, sir. So actually not. You just require a few training about how to deal with technology. That's it. That is enough for us to continue with YouTube channel.
Shall I add to Pashi, Payal Vashis?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, to start a YouTube channel, that we don't require any funding. Still, we require one Gmail ID from the YouTube.
Yes.
And based on that, that ID alone cannot help us to have more videos. It cannot have the more subscribers. It cannot have more money, so funding also.
Yes.
For that, we should have the more creative ideas. How to frame the videos, either from the videos or editing or the photographs and the good music or the audibility. There are some basic training programs are available in the YouTube channels also. Like to be a starter, you can have the basic YouTube developer kind of program is there, certification program is there. So that's a basic level. So once you can go through it, then you can have more exposures in that. And based on that, the ideas are there, how to create the videos, how to edit the videos. Then some amount of technological support is required to those kind of things is required to get it better and better. And
yeah.
Until certain views, if your videos have reached, a lot of guidelines are also there. We have to stick onto the guidelines. And once you have reached, your videos are reached, the next level eligibility for the paid these things, like how your video reaches, yes. All those things. So it has got a basic lot of processes that like it is available in the YouTube sites also. So people interested can go through it. And it takes time to learn, but once you learn, you can explore it. So that is what everyone always has a role to do it. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. Vikas sir, I have a question for you. That the first step you told was market research. So if you are working on an idea which is quite a bit unique and it does not have any prevailing resources or anything that we can research on, so how should we start the first step of market research for that idea?
Okay, again, so yeah, this is an excellent question. If you know you are looking into a new product or new service which is not exist in the market, then you need to identify who is the key target clients or prospective clients for that product and service, and you have to ask like I'll take an example, that YouTube channel creation, which is called a content creation. So like I'm opening my traveling channel, so I need to, you know, ask randomly that out of 100 people who are, you know, college going or who loves to travel, how many of them, so there are two type of research. One is primary and one is secondary, which will, you know very well about, but in marketing also you have to understand this. So how many are interested in travel channels, what they want particularly in that travel channel. So in that way, you can do your market research based on primary, you know, like questionnaire or kind of thing. Is that answer your question? So,
yes, it does. And there was another thing, that if we have something with us, if we have developed a prototype or something of an idea, but we have not yet patented it because it is yet requiring some modification. And we are afraid of presenting it to someone so that in content that our idea would be copied or made another copy. So in that case, what should we do, sir?
Again, so, you know, you need to have a kind of copyright registered. So if you are creating any application or web-based thing, then it will come like it automatically come with copyright and trademark. And if you have any product or service, then before presenting, that's what I mentioned, like to avoid future litigations, you need to have an agreement. So whenever you present it to any conference or anywhere, so there you will sign up an agreement that no one can use that idea anywhere, and like your idea, and you can't use anyone else's idea. So yeah, this kind of, you know, conferences or venture capitalists, they'll have that kind of mutual agreement always in place. So there are very rare chances that, you know, it get stolen, but yeah, you have to be careful. There have been cases where it got stolen.
Okay, fine. Thank you, sir.
In that, I can add one more thing that if you have an idea, then you can go for the idea patent, right? Once you can go for the any presentation or the conference, that idea is not your idea, and that is decided by the patent application person. So before any conference or the any presentation, you have to just go for the idea patent. And once you go for the idea patent, within 2 years, you have to complete your project. So that is the best way to protect your thoughts or their things. All right. So here we can end our webinar. So at the end, I just want to thanks to Dr. Vikas and Dr. Payal for giving your valuable time for our college and to the other student also. And I want to thanks to Bala sir as well as the Prakash sir to providing us such a platform to share such knowledge during this COVID-19 time. So everybody can use this knowledge once they can graduate or the postgraduate. So thank you all of you to participate in this webinar and make it successful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful weekend. Bye.
Bye, everyone.